What's going on, guys? It's K-Dub here with another episode of Crypto Zombie. So I hope everyone's having a really great weekend. I know I am. The weather is finally warming up a little bit in New York. As soon as I'm done with this video, I'm about to go outside and just breathe in the fresh air and just enjoy the weekend, which is what all of you should be doing. But since it is crypto and crypto never sleeps, here we are. So let's talk about what's going on in the market. So I do have a little bit of technical analysis I'd like to kind of go over today. Just kidding. So, guys, but a lot of people are saying, so Bitcoin has hit 4-week high, right? So we're coming over here, we're having a look that, you know, Bitcoin has been on quite a run, but now Bitcoin has been slowing down a little bit. So they say that the underperformance could be an indication that we are fueling up for altcoin season. So as you guys can see right here, we do have Bitcoin dominance. Actually, let's refresh live, 38.4. It's still 38.4, okay. But, you know, we are seeing this steady decline, which it is, you know, it goes up, it goes down, but the overall trend is down for Bitcoin dominance overall. And we are seeing, especially, look at, look at the altcoins. They're just going on a little bit of a run right now. So one of the coins that really just I noticed really exploded was Internet Node Token. Now, Internet Node Token has still seen quite a dip from the all-time high of where it was before. But I've spoken about this project many, many times on my channel. And this recent volume increase, it may have something to do with them releasing this progress report. There was a lot of FUD around this project, whether or not it was legitimate. There was some stuff that went on with the media relations woman and some kind of funny business with the money. Then on top of that, to make matters worse, they were having an issue with the ERC-20 token itself, the smart contract. It wouldn't send tokens. You had to use a ton of gas, and then sometimes you had to leave a certain amount of tokens in your wallet. So there was just really rough start for this project. But it looks like they're finally starting to sort things out a little bit, and that probably has a lot to do with the increase. And eventually, you know, they will be utilizing their own mainnet as well in the future. So that's something to consider. So that might be some of that excitement towards that. And, you know, we're seeing a lot of growth in a lot of altcoins. I mean, if we go over to basically the chart, we go over to the changes in volume right now. I mean, still DentaCoin again. Dentists, man, they love their coins, right? So obviously Game.com, that was a big one. That was the whole news with Tron and all that. Elf has a lot coming out of the camp lately. Golem, you know, they just had the Brass Golem big release happening. And, you know, I mean, these are all coins that deserve to be there. 0x, Zilliqa, Enigma, Aeon, Monero, IOTA, Arc, Kyber. I mean, R-Chain, Power Ledger, I mean, Komodo, all of these coins really deserve to be seeing the green that they're seeing. So yeah, really great start to the week. Well, technically Sunday is the first day of the week, technically, according to the calendar. But you know what I mean, guys. So I'm actually surprised that we didn't see as much of a dip as we normally see on the weekend. And we're already at a $394 billion market cap. So that looks very, very good. I'm very happy to see these numbers again, guys. Also, did you see Charlie Lee? He says the flapping is at 45%, guys. You need to flap harder. And then Roger Ver goes, didn't you sell off your Litecoin? And then Charlie Lee goes, didn't you sell off your Bitcoin for Bcash? So I think it's just so funny how there's this constant battle back and forth between these guys all the time. But also, speaking of the big story of Bitcoin Cash, you may have heard about this. For those of you that haven't, I just wanted to bring it to you. So Bitmain says that they're going to be burning 12% of Bitcoin Cash transaction fees, and they call on all other miners to follow. They say, while having active users spending Bitcoin Cash is very important for the ecosystem, having investors who hold Bitcoin Cash is also a fundamental requirement for maintaining a strong economy. Without these holders, Bitcoin Cash's exchange value loses significant support. We believe that they too should profit from the growth of Bitcoin Cash by their continued stake in the ecosystem. The transaction fees earned by miners are an important growth indicator of the ecosystem, and if a portion of the fees are burnt, it is effectively miners sharing revenue with the entire network. By reducing the total supply of Bitcoin Cash in circulation, Bitmain believes that it can reduce sell pressure on the coin, ultimately making it more valuable. So, okay. I get what they're trying to say here. Burn coins, make them more valuable. Binance is doing the same thing. But it seems kind of strange to me that if, you know, this is supposed to be the original vision of Satoshi, but we have to like burn tokens to create incentive for people to hold. Whereas with Bitcoin, we just hold because we believe in the tech, we like what it is, and it's free market, it's the people's money, right? So I don't know. Funny how like Bitcoin's just Bitcoin, just kind of does its thing. Bitcoin Cash kind of always has to do all these like, you know, jump through hoops and put on shows and do burns and then have, you know, the Bitcoin Cash ladies, you know, and they're all, you know, they have the BCH, please. I don't know. It just seems like it's always like a song and a dance and a show for the whole Bitcoin Cash thing. I don't know. I don't own any Bitcoin Cash. I had some back in the day and I just didn't see the point of it. And now with Bitcoin transactions as low as they are and Lightning Network, yeah, whatever. But hey, to those of you that love Bitcoin Cash and that's your thing, that's your thing. I don't know. For me, it's, I don't really personally care about the coin. So speaking of the Key, so the Key announces their platform for identity verification and pension claims. So the token is going to be utilized in the second generation of DMI technology known as blockchain-based dynamic multi-dimensional identification. Did you guys get all that? So the testnet for BDMI is scheduled to be released in the middle of this year, and the mainnet is planned to be released at the end of this year. There will be three components in the BDMI ecosystem. You have the participants, which includes the validators, the service providers, and the individual users, the smart contracts, and of course, you have the TKY token. So services that currently utilize the Key's DMI technology will be gradually migrated to the BDMI technology after the release of the mainnet. Now, currently, they've been sort of testing this in what they refer to as the zone. So the zone is an important ecological asset for the administration as it's a natural barrier for Northeast Asia's terrestrial ecosystem as well as Northeast China's great granary. So up until now, the process of obtaining survival certifications was a very time-consuming and miserable experience for these elderly people. You know, they would have to essentially make a difficult journey to walk to this ID center. So this technology is going to basically help them because it's going to be using facial recognition technology and they'll be able to apply for these certifications from the comfort of their own home, essentially. So based on the success of the Key's product, the Key and the administration are planning to expand it to online social insurance payments, medical online purchases, and family mutual aid, etc. So the partnership will allow the Key to explore the application of medical treatments based on personal credit, payment by installments of healthcare security, and direct compensation of commercial insurance. So I know a lot of people always ask me about the Key, especially in my Telegram group. So that's basically what they're doing. They are currently in the process of rolling things out, slamming down those milestones, acquiring partnerships, and having real-world application, which is really all you can ask for, guys. So then you have OKCoin's parent company offering $100 million to support EOS. So OK Blockchain Capital, which is a venture capital company owned by the OK Group, just announced its enthusiastic support for the EOS network in the form of $100 million for projects to make use out of it. So in its announcement, the company also said that it's going to add more incubators in countries like the US, Singapore, Switzerland, and others as well. So that is more good news for EOS. Also, wanted to touch really quick. So VeChain has officially introduced multi-party payment protocol. So basically this MPP, multi-payment protocol, is designed to facilitate transactions between multiple parties, even if data is being moved from one non-token owner to another non-token owner. Therefore, everyday users will use the VeChain Thor blockchain with or without the knowledge of it. So they define this as a tool within their Oracle enabler tool, allowing parties other than the sender involved in on-chain transactions to opt to pay for the network fees of the transactions to the blockchain. So what is this solving exactly? So one of the major obstacles for ordinary people and enterprise adopting a blockchain is the uncertainty and complex in dealing with crypto assets. For enterprises, most won't go out of their way to use cryptocurrencies and they can't derive policy from the structure of proposed payment models of the blockchain. So if you come down here, you can look at all the steps. They go into extreme detail. So I can drop a link for this if you guys are curious about how it works. But I just wanted to let you know that that's more coming out of VeChain. Also, did you guys see over here WikiLeaks? They're calling for a global blockade as Coinbase banned the WikiLeaks shop without explanation. So down here, you could see the official tweet. I had actually pulled it up right here. It says WikiLeaks will call for a global blockade of Coinbase next week as an unfit member of the crypto community. Coinbase, a large Californian Bitcoin processor, responding to a concealed influence, has blocked the entirely harmless WikiLeaks shop in a decision approved by management. So, man, it's funny because, you know, then you come down and you see all these other guys who are proponents of it. You know, you have the Trump Spring, you have Andreas Antonopoulos saying, "I'm pretty sure symbolic, unlike the first embargo, now many options, but the symbolism is pretty poignant reminder of what centralization and banking regulations mean." He says, "We have come full circle. Many people's interest in Bitcoin started when WikiLeaks was out under the radar after they had their whole issue where they basically didn't allow people to buy or donate using credit cards. So then they had to accept Bitcoin," which is funny because that was back when Bitcoin was really, really cheap. So then WikiLeaks actually ended up sitting on a ton of Bitcoin, which skyrocketed in value. So these guys just cannot get a break. But anyway, moving on to other news, you do see that, so there's this study that it's basically trying to claim that Ethereum is more decentralized than Bitcoin. Now, I did show you guys that chart the other day of Bitmain and all of their associates essentially owning more than 51% of the Bitcoin, you know, pool. So a study done by Cornell says that less Ethereum nodes are linked to institutions or organizations than Bitcoin, which means that more nodes on the Ethereum network are operated by individuals rather than companies. So the data showed that Ethereum nodes are both in the latency space and also geographically more distributed around the world. Ethereum nodes tend to come from all sorts of places, smaller networks and homegrown entities, as opposed to Bitcoin nodes, which tend to be located in data centers. So that was sort of what they were saying over there. And then in other news, I did want to talk about the code for Ethereum's consensus change is now ready for review. So the new code written to change the way that the Ethereum network is going to reach its consensus is now ready for review. So this is the Ethereum Improvement Proposal number 1011, known as Hybrid Casper Friendly Finality Gadget. So this would implement the first steps in a long-planned shift away from the energy-intensive mining process and toward an allegedly greener method, which is called minting. So Vitalik says that if implemented, this would be a first partial step towards the full move to Casper, introducing a hybrid system that is going to combine proof of work and proof of stake. So while it's a long time in the making as far as Casper is concerned, it's still controversial in some quarters. For example, a security researcher at VMware called it fundamentally vulnerable as of last month. But as these pieces of the puzzle are getting closer to being completed, it's time to start talking about fork block numbers. So this change will not be compatible with existing Ethereum software, meaning that the network will have to undergo a hard fork in order to be implemented. That said, there's still some way to go before that happens. So I just want to throw that out there, guys. So yes, they are looking, they're ready for review. We have hybrid Casper friendly finality gadget, but we may need a hard fork in the future. So just letting you guys know about that. Also, for my Richard Hart fans out there, Byteball, yes, Byteball, the coin that nobody ever talks about. So Byteball, they are launching a new tool which makes organization of an ICO a lot more straightforward. Thanks to the integration of verifyinvestor.com, the team is introducing an ICO platform which mainly targets accredited investors. This allows ICO projects to sell securities without any big problems, although it means they may not be able to attract thousands of investors. So if you guys don't know about Byteball, Byteball actually has really great technology. It's just kind of one of those coins. It's just not really sexy. Nobody really ever talks about it. So that's pretty cool seeing that Byteball is going to be launching their own ICOs. That's pretty good for them moving forward. And guys, that's basically it for the news today. There wasn't really too much going on, and honestly, I'm okay with that. I don't mind kind of a calm day in crypto. I don't mind just kind of taking a break. It's totally cool. You know, I actually think that what we're doing right now with this sideways kind of pattern, we're not parabolic or anything. We're sort of just still accumulating. Some people are saying we might have a slight dip before we go back up, but honestly, I'm happy with this growth. I'll take this growth any day. It's more time for accumulation and it's a lot healthier than what we saw earlier in this year. So that being said, guys, I hope that all of your houses look like this with your green candles shooting through the roof and it's just wonderful gains in crypto. And also, just for fun, I saw this. So, if you had to choose one to protect you and the other five try to hack you, who would you pick? So, you have John McAfee, Vitalik, you have Jimmy Song, CZ, Andreas Antonopoulos, and Roger Ver. So, what do you guys think? I don't know. I'm kind of going with either McAfee or CZ. Because CZ's like the man. But McAfee, he's got like guns and stuff. So, he might have to play dirty. But, yeah, I don't know. What do you guys think? Drop in the comments below. Let me know. So anyway, just figured I'd have a little bit of fun at the end of the show. My name is K-Dub. This is Crypto Zombie. Shout out to everyone that's been liking, subscribing, and commenting. You guys are freaking awesome. And until next time, guys, stay crypto. And of course, peace out.